Hello from Athens, Greece. Today, as we are approaching the 100 videos in my channel, you will see the lecture I make for the Discord channel, Chess Academy. So, what is the Discord? Discord is an application, okay? So, it is a community that you can speak with your friends, you can make a lecture and everyone can hear you and see you also. And there are some very interesting chess channels, okay? The lecture that you will see, it is about Bishop versus Knight in the ending, in the end game that I gave some days ago in the Discord channel Chess Academy. Chess Academy is a very good channel, very user-friendly. There are about more than 2,000 members now. And I want to thank them, the Killer Queen, that is the first person there, and also the people that helped me to make possible this lecture and helped me with recording this lecture just for you. Don't lose more time and start to see the lecture.
Yes, okay. Hello to everyone. My name is Andreas Germiadianos from Athens, Greece. So today we will see how to think in the end game with Bishop versus Knight. Okay, so the most important thing is to understand what is the movement of every piece and what that means to all the end game we will study. So let's try a position without anything and try to understand something here. Okay, in order to attack this pawn, the knight from f4 needs 4 moves. It is exactly the same like the knight is coming from a1, because it is also 4 moves, okay? And here it's also 4 moves, it's the same. So, that's very important. This we can call the diagonal distance, from the knight to 3 squares, 2 squares diagonally, okay? So, let's see something else. The knight also is not easy to deal with the pawn on the edge of the board. So, when we have a position that a knight has to deal with the pawn on the edge of the board, then the position is not easy to handle the h pawn like in this position here. Okay, so the knight has these two problems. Another problem is that the knight cannot lose tempo. So, the bishop on the other side can lose tempo. It is better because it's a long range piece to have in both sides of the board, to have pawns in both sides of the board. So, that's why the bishop sometimes is a better piece. Okay, we will start first to see an example and then. Okay, and then we'll discuss about all this. Here, we have the first critical point of the position. Generally, you have to know that the position with the bishop does not want to be pawns on these 4 lines. So, in this position, it's better just not to have these pawns. There are 3 reasons for this. First one is because the king has to use the e5 square, so he cannot attack from both sides. Okay? The second one, it is because generally the central pawns give knight an outpost. So we do not have the knight to have an outpost on the center. And the third one, not to disturb our bishops to go to both sides. Here is not a problem, of course. So, that's why in this position, black played f6. So, there is a reason also you can play h6, but we see we have to keep the h-pawn because it is very difficult for the knight to make defense against the h-pawn. So, f6. King e3 and g5. Now take, 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 and take. Knight d1, king f2, and black finally occupy the central e5 pawn. Knight f2, they played a few moves. Now king c4 is the threat. Okay, and now we come to the first important strategy that we should know. One of the few things that the position does right are the strategies that you can use. Okay, we can think the rules about the movement of the pieces. That explains to us why the knight cannot lose a tempo, because he has to change color with every move. But what it is not written in the books are basic strategy what to do. The first basic strategy, you have asymmetrical play. You want asymmetrical play. You want your king to go to the one side and the other king to go to the other side. This is the easiest way for black to win. Why this happened? Because the bishop is a long range piece. So this bishop, just look at this position. You go to take the h7 pawn, I go to take the e3 pawn. This bishop can control your pawn and help my pawns to promote. The knight has to choose one side, to go to help the passed pawn or to stop my passed pawns. Okay, so that's very important to understand. The first one strategy to win in these endgames are asymmetrical play. You want the king to go to other sides. This is the easiest way to win. That's why the second strategy is sometimes to give a check with the bishop, so the opponent has to choose where to go, and you go with your king to the other side. Okay, so we'll see all this, and that's why this position is not what white is aiming for. So knight e4 was playing, knight c3, knight b5 is the threat, bishop f1, okay, this is not important, and now we have the second critical point here. Okay, now black all the time has to move his king to e3 and d3. The problem is that I cannot move the bishop to put on g6 to make a chutzvank, because the knight will come to b5 threatening this pawn. That's why I need to make schematic thinking, as Sereshevsky said in his fantastic book Endgame Strategy. Okay, in the end game, it is not so important to calculate variations, but it's very important to have schematic thinking. So, that's why this doesn't do anything. Okay? And b5 is a very difficult move to understand, because you have to make the setup. Sometimes, we put the pawns on the color of our bishop. The idea is just so the bishop can protect this pawn, okay? And then our king can go to the other side. For example, in this position, we play a6, and now you see that white is chutzvank. Because if you move the knight, the king can come to c4. If you move the king can come to d4. Okay? So it's not easy for white to find the move. A4 was played, and now we take on A4, take with the knight, and come with the king. Of course, knight C5 allows A5, we see, cannot sacrifice the knight because we have the good bishop, it is a pawn on the h-file, and we control the h1 square, this is a winning position. That's why he played knight b2. bishop f5, and just Zugzwang again. Okay, you see now it's very clear. The knight protects c4, the king protects these two squares. So white has no moves to do. King d2, king d4, and now white shown with white find a very interesting defense. He put the king on c1 and b2. We have to understand what is his idea. Okay, it's very important not just to move pieces. The most important to do in chess is to think what your opponent will do. That's why in this position the idea of white is to sacrifice the bishop for this pawn. If the bishop can come to these two squares and I cannot control him, then he sacrifices for the h7 pawn and I cannot win because this bishop does not control the a1 square. It is a draw. Okay? Bishop f5 is the only good move because if the knight comes to f2, the bishop restricts the knight. And if the knight comes to e3, bishop b6 also restricts the knight. If you play g4, h6, knight f5, just take and you win because we have two passed pawns. So, knight g2 was played. Now, king c4. To control these two squares, you will understand why. After knight f4, and we see that the knight has no square to come close to the h7 pawn. So, white is going to take the a pawn, but black king is going to take the g3 pawn. And now we see the position is winning, and black resigns because cannot stop the h pawn from winning. So, let's try to see all the important stages very quickly. First of all, the king can come to the middle game. He makes a fortress. Then I'm coming to h3 and play h4. He stopped me playing h4. And now I have to disappear all the pawns from the f line, so the king can have access to the e5 square. And after e5, I'm thinking about Zugzwang. We play some moves, and now b5, the most important point, so the pawn will be protected, and then the bishop can come to make the Zugzwang, and the position is winning for white. Okay? So, let's go to see another example. So, just for me, it's very important to know only this endgame by heart. Then you can compare all the other endgames with this one. This is very easy. So, we have this endgame, okay? We know this is winning, but why it is winning? Don't forget, because we have a better king. Okay, let's go to the next one. So, in this position, there are some differences, okay, with the previous one. First of all, we have only one pawn on the queen side. There are not two pawns, so it's not easy to make the plan we make in the previous game. Second detail, my king is on g8, not on g7 to come to f6. So, these two shows that the position is okay for white, but there is a very big minus in this position. And this is the knight on d4. You understand that the knight on d4 is not in the good square. Okay, the knight on d4 has to be on c3. On d4 he will be fine if we are looking about middle game. But now we are in the end game. It's important that the best square for the knight is when you make a fortress. Okay, so here c3 is the best square. So this position, this seems very strange, but whoever play has the best results. If white is playing in this position, it is a dead draw, because they can play b4, f4 to make a fortress, knight e2, and we see we have the previous position, but we cannot make the final Zugzwang because there is no b5 pawn. Okay? So, but in this position, it is white's black turn to move. So, black played king f8. And now you see white is missing one tempo. B4, king e7, knight e2, and now there is no time for white. If you play a4, the king is coming to d5. If you play the knight on c3, the king is coming to e5. So, as we see, this position can be okay for white, but they are missing one tempo. So, king f1 was played to bring the king very close, and we see that we have the king in the center in a very nice position in the fourth rank. Okay, white king is in the third rank. h4, and now how to proceed. It's very good to remember the basic strategy, okay? The basic strategy is that we want to create a symmetrical play. The one king in the one side and the other king in the other side. In order to do this, we have just to give a check with the bishop. Thus, the best move here is bishop c8. Now, bishop a6 is coming. Knight f3, check. And wherever the king goes, our king, the black king, go the other way. So, if you go here, I go here. And now, you just take a pawn. This is not important because we have the asymmetrical play. The position is easily winning for black. So, that's why he chose the other way. He went to c3. And now, of course, there is no reason to play king 4 and give a pawn. First, h6. Now, knight f5 is the idea. Okay, g6. We see sometimes I'm putting the pawn on the color of my bishop. The idea is just to protect my pawns and also not to lose a pawn without a reason. So, if you play f3, bishop f1. Now, he has to choose how to continue. He played knight c2 and king e4. In this kind of position, another great strategy that my friend Papaioannou Ioannis, a very strong grandmaster, told me, it is that white can choose where to put their knight. If they put the knight close to the king, then white will be chuchvang. If the knight goes far away from the king, then he can be lost. Okay, we will see this now. If he goes here, we play a5. This is the game. F4 is coming. And bishop f1, because my bishop will threaten the white pawns, the white pawns will be pushed, okay, and they will create weaknesses. And that will be very easy for my king to invade. King d2, f4, and now he has to choose. If he goes to c2, just to protect everything. Another concept that you have to remember is that sometimes the bishop and the knight can be mutual chuchvang, reciprocal chuchvang. Okay, so we are playing a pawn endgame. So you have to move some pawns, and then I move the bishop, and we play again an endgame with bishop versus knight. Okay, so king e5, and now this is a very good exercise how to proceed with black. G5 and take with the king. Okay, in the end game we think with plans. White is winning. Black is winning. So that's why. Sorry, he chose to put the knight on G4. Now you see the knight is very far away from the king, so it has to be very careful. Knight D7, bishop C8, because if you move away to c5, then king g4 is coming. Knight f8 and g5. If you take, you see suddenly the knight is lost. And also it seems you have some chances. You don't have any. Okay. So. That's why he played g3. Take on h4, take. King g4. Knight g6. Bishop f5. And one pawn is lost. B4, take on h4. King d3, king g4. But he cannot deal with the h pawn. Okay, you see the knight cannot do anything when there is an H or an A pawn. And the position is lost, of course he resigns. So, I think for now, let's go to see all these rules together. Okay, and after we continue. So, let's go to see some of the rules. Give me one moment. Together. Okay, I will speak in Greek, but they are in Greek, but it's also I have it in English somewhere, but for now it's the same, doesn't matter. So first of all, the bishop is in long range. Okay, so he wants pawns on both sides. Okay, it's better not to have central pawns. The knight cannot deal with a pawn on the H or the A file, and the knight cannot lose tempo. And the strategies are asymmetrical play. Okay, the king has to go to other side. Reciprocal Zugzwang, bishop with knight, to give a check, so the opponent's king will go to the one side and will go to the next to the other side. And of course, how to convert our advantage. Okay, that was quick. And we are back now. This is a difficult one, Kasparov-Karpov. There is no reason to see, but this is a very interesting position. Okay. Okay, cheers. And we have Karpov versus Polgar. Now it's very easy to understand everything after the example that we show. Okay, so here Karpov played king f3, of course. We understand that the king has to go to the center very quickly. King f7 and king e4. Now we have two plans with white here, because there are two pawn breaks. We think always with pawn breaks in the endgame, okay? So, the first one is with our strategy to play f4, f5. So, there will be no central pawns, okay, on the E or the F line. And then, we'll have access to the d5 square. But, this will be the only plan if the black pawn were on b7. Now, we have also a target here. That's why in the endgame, we don't push pawns without a reason. You must have another mentality. It's not the same, the middle game and the end game. So here also we have a target, so we can play a4. Let's see. a4. Now, what to do? If he takes on a4, then the a4 pawn is lost. Okay? So, he has to put his knight on a7. We just take, and now to see how he will take. If he takes with the knight, a simple rule to understand. When we have in pawn endgames our king in the fifth rank, 90% you are winning. Okay? It's a simple rule of thumb. So you will understand. Space is very important in king and pawn and games. Let's see how. I just push my pawn. The problem is that he has no tempo, because if he push his pawn, then my king can come inside. So I just push my pawns. I play g5. And he's losing because of the f6 square. That's why Polgar took with the pawn here, and we have the medial Zugzwang. The bishop and the knight cannot move. The pawn cannot move because it will be lost. My king will come from d4. So f4 was played, and now you see Karpov he lose a tempo. To have the same position, it was black turns to play. He saw the variation e5, okay, it is winning for him, but he doesn't want to allow black to play e5. That's why he put the bishop on d3, just you see how the bishop can lose a tempo, and we have the same position. It is black's turn to move, and after king d7, we can play e5, and black cannot play e5. So, if he take, okay, king g6, and now just wait. You see, it is too strong for black. Because if the king goes to g8, then I can come to e5 and d5 winning. Okay, that's why he chose to put the king on d6. He take and we take. Now, I think if you saw the lecture from the beginning, it's very easy to find the way that Karpov continued to play. Bishop h3 check. In order to choose where the black king will go, and he will go with his king to the other side. So, after king e7, king d5 is winning. You see, the pawn will be lost. That's why Polgar went to d6 and go to e5. If you go to e7, the same like before, Chujvang, you have to move and I'm coming to d5 winning, or you have to push the pawn and also the pawn will be lost. For example, I'm threatening the pawn, and if you move the pawn, then king b6 winning the knight.
Andreas, I just wanted to mention that it seems as though your video went off again.
Sorry.
Everything else has been very smooth so far, no technical difficulties other than that.
Okay. I don't know what this is going, what is happening.
I think it might have been the issue that we were talking about before, where you are recording and screen sharing and doing the video at the same time. I'll just let you know if it happens again.
It's okay? Now?
Yep.
Okay, when this happened, tell me immediately. So, to go back, so, if king e7, we said king g6, bishop f1, and I'm going to d5, or if you push the pawn, you are losing the pawn or the knight, okay? Because you cannot see the screen. Now I think it's okay. So, Polgar choose to sacrifice a pawn, played g5. He give the h-pawn, so to have some chances to keep my king locked up. Okay, but this is a very good move once more, looking that the bishop can control the knight, and we have one chujvang that no piece will move again. If you just play before, h4, and just give the bishop, and of course the knight cannot come very close to the h-pawn. Once more, we see the same strategy. That's why king e7 was played immediately, and then black took on b5, took on g5, and king h6. You see how important it is for the king to go farther every time. g4, h3. Black resigns here, but let's move a little bit to understand why. b5, knight f7, check, okay, b6, now the knight cannot move, I push the pawn on the king's side. And now you see, this is a very interesting concept also to understand, that the knight control not only the two squares, e4 and e5, but also the e5 and e3, because if our king goes there, there will be check from c4. So you see that the knights control these four squares and they make a gamma. It is the move of the knight. It's very interesting this. We'll see a lot of this in fortress with knights. But the position is just to move the king here from f3, e2, d3 and white wins easily going around. Okay? I think this shows a very easy way how Karpov mastered all this endgame. It is quite normal for him. And now we'll see an endgame from Lasker. White is checkover, black is Lasker, and it's an interesting concept to understand what black white will do to make a fortress. Okay, white has two ideas: to play bishop b2 now or to play b5 and bishop b2. Okay, if I play bishop b2, he will play a4, and after my b5, he will take, and he have a pawn on b3. If I play b5 first, then after bishop b2, he will have a pawn on a4. So the difference will be if white will have a pawn on b3 or on a4. As it seems, it's better for me the pawns to be on a4. That's why Lasker played b5. Bishop b2 is not good. Let's see. Okay, there is time for white to make defense. So b5 is a very nice move, and then bishop b2. King e1, bishop b2, a4, take on a4, and now in the end game, all the time we have to understand that the king has to go with double purpose, to do two things, not one. King b6 is not so good because tempo, threatening the h2, tempo, and white just keep the position. That's why we go to c6, to go to c5 and to have two ideas. If the knight move, to go to d4, if sometimes to b4. And the idea is that after king c2, we have this move, a very important tempo, and king c4, because we took too much space with the king. The space of the king is very important in the endgame. Knight c3, king b4, knight b5 and a5. Of course, we keep the pawn on the a and h file, because the knight cannot deal with this pawn. Okay, you see, it's not important where the knight is coming to take all the other pawns on the king side, because with one pawn we can win. And now, of course, there is a tempo. This is worse because I play king b3 and a4. So he chose to play king c2, bishop e5, take and take, knight to d8, and we see once more we put the pawns on the color of our bishop, so we can protect these pawns. Knight c6, bishop to g1, f3, and bishop c5. The position is lost. You see once more the knight is far away from the king, so he can be lost. G4, bishop e7, g5 take, and simply come to c4. If you take the pawn, bishop e7, and the knight cannot move. We are playing an endgame with kings and pawn up. Okay. This is a difficult one. One moment. Okay, let's see. White just played a4. Okay, they have a pawn majority on the queen side, and they want to create a passed pawn. So, black has to choose how to continue. Here, there is a very interesting idea. Can you find what is the idea of white? How white should continue? The idea is that if you don't play h5, white, they will play h5, and very important concept for all the endgame: never take on g6. If you take on g6, you want a target on g6, okay? But push the pawn to h7. G6 is also a target. I will sacrifice the bishop. It is like I take here, but it's very important to know this concept. Put the pawn to h6. Okay, h6 or a6 in the other side. This is a very important concept. Never take on g6. If we are in the middle game, of course you take on g6 to open the h line to make an attack. But the end game is not middle game. Just puts the pawn to h6, then h6, h7 is a target, and also g6 is a target. Okay, if you take, you have just one target. If you push, you have two targets. That's why, as we said before, in order to stop our pawn break, Black has to put his pawn where we do the break. We want to put the break with h5, so Black play h5. King d4. Check, king c3, and Black is waiting. a5, of course. And now we see that White has to find a way to go to attack the g6 weakness. Black react very well. Play check and knight a7. Now they block this diagonal with knight c6. If you take on c6 and king d4, then king b5 and you cannot win. How we count this endgame? Because I see a lot of my students doing this mistake. I take, he take, I go to e6, go to e5, go to f6, go to play b5. This is the wrong way. Because you are playing for 4 or 5 hours. Then you have no time. You are tired. It's very easy to miscalculate something. So, the idea how to count the moves in this position is like this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Just your moves, then his moves. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So there is nothing to see. Okay? White cannot win this position. They are even worse. So that's why you cannot take on c6. King c3. And now, this is a very good concept from Marovitz. It's not easy to find. No one of my students find it, and some of them are close to 2,200. Okay? Because in this position, you cannot take the knight. But after king c3, this is a very good move, threatening to take the knight. Very simple, because if you take now with the king, king a4 and b5 check. You sacrifice the pawn, and you go and you win on the other side. So, in the game he took with the b-pawn. King c3, king d7, king d4, king d6. Okay, make some triangulation, nothing not so important here. And a6, decoying. Okay, give the one pawn. Now, if king b8, it is a well-known mating pattern. Check, king c7, queen, check, check, and mate. So, he chose to play d4 immediately. a7, you take, and king e5. So, we have to have a clear calculation in this position, clear calculation of the plans and of the moves. So, it is easy to understand that the position is losing. Because I will have a queen with check, and I will first of all put some checks to centralize my queen, and then I take the pawn on h5 and the position is winning. Okay, this is a very interesting position. There was a draw in this position. This is very strange. Okay, Fleer is a grandmaster from England. He knows very good endgames. Okay, he has two books, very interesting book, Improving the Endgame and Mastering the Endgame from Everyman Chess Publications. And they are both good books. So I'm thinking that Fleer was the player that proposed the draw. And White accepted, although in this position, the position is lost for Black. Let's see. King a4. Knight d5. I can come to g5. If you protect, I take the pawn, and I protect my pawn. Okay? It's winning him easily. So, after 95 here, if you go to b4 immediately, take on g6, and of course the knight cannot deal with the h7 with the h4 pawn. Knight c8, king g5, king f7, and king h6. We see once more mutual chutzvang between the bishop and the knight. You see the same ideas all the time, again and again, are coming in the game, in every game. So if you move the knight, king h7, a4, also this is winning immediately. You have too much space with the king, but okay. a5 and bishop c5. Chutzvang again. The two pieces cannot move, and I'm coming to g8 winning. So let's go to see the a6 now. Again, bishop c5. The same idea. If a5, a4, and you have one more pawn on the color of the bishop. King f6, king g8. Now there are two targets, the g6 pawn and the knight on c8. King f7, take on g6, king f7, and the knight will be lost. This is an endgame from Aliekhin. Okay, you see passed pawn on the A file, just to win a tempo. I'm coming, check, bishop protect the pawn on A4, and I'm coming with the king. He's protecting with the king on F2. And H5. Now I have to create a chutzvang. King H3, I'm coming, king H2. Just moving around, and bishop to d3. And g6, white is chutzvang. If you go to e3, I just give the bishop, and you cannot deal with the two passed pawns on the h and the a line. If you come to f3, king g1 and g4. Now, it seems that white has some counterplay, but if you calculate well, there is no counter chances here. King h2, going for the h4 pawn. Very interesting try. f5, take with the bishop. And the point is that h5 is not a threat, because I can simply take it. If you take the bishop, I play h4, and the pawn will be a queen. If you take here, the knight cannot move, and I'm coming to take the knight. And black resigns. And we are coming to one of the greatest, like Rubinstein here. It is one of my favorite. Kramnik and Rubinstein are my favorite players. Rubinstein is the only player not to give him a chance to play for the World Chess Championship match. He was a fantastic player, and Lasker was afraid of him. That's why he didn't accept to play. And after many years, when there was no excuse and he has to play a match, there was the First World War. And after the war, Rubinstein, it was with psychological problems, and it was not easy to play to the same level like before. So here we see that the knight and the bishop are also mutual chutzvang, because the c2 pawn is under attack. King e7, bring the king as quickly as possible, and this is a bad move. Why it is a bad move? Also, according to Sereshevsky in this fantastic endgame strategy book, in order to win, you need two weaknesses from your opponent. Now white create a second weakness on his own. The first one is the weakness on c2, the second one is the weakness on g4. So, king d6 was played. King d6 is make room for bishop d7, okay? g6. Now, the king protects the c2, and white wants to activate the knight with knight f3. Bishop d7, now h5 is a threat. So you see, the problem is one time I attack the c2 pawn, one time I attack the g4 pawn. And a very nice defense from Reti. Now you cannot play h5 because knight h4 is coming. Take g5 and everything was exchanged. So, in this position, how to proceed? h5 is not a good move. One moment. So this does not disturb. Okay. And simple. This is one of the points that is not easy to find the move, because generally we want to create something. In the end game, we think with the word progress. How to make a progress? Here, I want to make a progress with h5. His defense is to put the knight on h4, attacking g6. So, how to protect it with the king? Simple moves. King protect g6. h5 is coming now. You see, after knight h4, king f7. Simply. And now, the king cannot protect because the c2 pawn will be lost. If you take, then the h3 pawn will be lost. Very nice. Knight h2. You see once more the mutual chutzvang between bishop and knight. King d6. Now, if you take and you play h4, the king is coming from f5. Once more, you have the weaknesses on c2 and the weaknesses on f4 and g4 square. You cannot protect all. That's why king e2 was played. And now, a very good move, d4. If you play c4, then the king can come to c6, play b5, and coming with the king to a4. White took on d4, and now we open the road to our king to the b4 square. Take on g4, once more the chutzvang. Bishop c6. Why? Because white want to activate the knight from f3. To put the knight on f3 and h4 create some chances. Bishop c6 does not allow this. King e2 and bishop d5. a3 and b5. Knight f1 and a5. You see? Now be careful. All the time I see the same and the same mistakes. Not before. Think what the other will do. After before a4 and we lost all the advantage. After bishop c6, knight b3, and it is not easy to win anymore. So, that's why Rubinstein chose to play a4. You see, once more, b4 sacrifice. Because the a4 decides the game. The knight cannot deal with the a or the h pawn. Knight e4, he tried to play this, but check. And now b4, king d2, take king c1, and just creating an entrance for the black king to the e5 square. I think you see until now that we have the same motives all the time. Centralization of the king, invade with the king, create a passed pawn on the h or the a line, mutual chutzvang. Okay, this is a very technical game that we can see. f4. King f6, king f2, just coming with the king to the center. And now, can you find the way to continue? It is something that we saw many times in the previous example. I didn't speak about this because it is well known to many endgames, even with rooks. Just threaten the opponent's king pawns, so he will create weaknesses and your king will invade and attack the pawns. If f5, h4 and bishop f7 is coming, g6 will have many problems. If king e7, bishop c6 and king c5. And white wins very easily. That's why black played f6. And now attacking the pawn to create weaknesses. We see g5 is the square and white will invade through f5. King e5, he goes to the other side. We know that according to our strategy, we have asymmetrical play, so the position is very easily winning. You cannot take the pawn because of bishop e8. So g takes f4, g takes f4, knight b6, bishop e8, and knight d5, bishop c6, and black is lost. After knight g4, h3, and h4, and black resigns. Okay, this is another easy example, because white wants to play the bishop to g4 and to c8. The counter chances lie in the move knight d5 to attack the b4 pawn. Bishop f3. If you go to d5, the idea is just to take here, and don't forget, 3 pawns versus 2 all the time can create a passed pawn. Even if they are not easy, they can do it with the sacrifice of a pawn. b5, take, and c6. Okay, so knight d5 is not possible. Knight e6 was played and king e4. f6, take, and now the knight has to be very careful where to go, because bishop c8 is on the air. b7 is a weakness. King e7 and king e5. White, of course, is winning. Knight e8, and once more, the mutual chuchwank of bishop and knight. Knight f7, king e4. Knight d8, king g5. And king h6, king h7. And now we lose a tempo. Also, this is winning immediately, okay. But like in the game, also bishop d7 and bishop now to c8. So you are moving and black is lost. How is lost? We can see if it goes immediately, it's the same idea. Just take. And first take the g6 pawn and then go for the b7 pawn. Okay, this is a very interesting exercise from Papayoannou. It's a very good friend of mine, a strong grandmaster, the champion of Greece. You see how to proceed in this position. You are with white. It's very important to understand how to make a fortress. Schematic thinking is what we should understand here. Just put the knight on d3 and b3 the pawn. Then you have a fortress, because with the knight on d3 and the pawn on b3, no one can come to any of these 6 squares. So this is the idea here. It's a draw. You see, black cannot invade anywhere. This is a position that we have the bishop, and now let's see how to proceed. White is threatening to play e5. Okay, e5 is a very good move for white. If I allow white to play e5, then I will be lost, because the bishop will be a very bad piece. And also, because I want to tell this, after e5, what is the problem when we have the bishop on the same color as our pawns? This is a very important concept to know, because everybody knows this not for a good reason. They know it wrong. Okay, because Many books also write this idea wrong. The problem when you put the bishop in the same square as your pawns is not that the bishop has not way to move. Even if your bishop is in this square that has a lot of square to move, it is a very bad position. There is no difference if the bishop is on g8 or g4. The problem when we have the bishop on the light squares and the pawn on the light squares is that we cannot control the dark squares. In chess, never forget that we play in two colors, the white and the dark. Okay, so if you have bishop and pawn on the light squares, who will control the dark squares? After e5 here, all the dark squares will be weak. Okay, so now we know that for a good player here, there is no need to calculate. There is only one move, e5. Because if white plays e5, white can only win. e5, maybe you sacrifice a pawn, but you open also the position. The e5 pawn will be lost. You see, knight f3 cannot be played because I take on e4. If I come with the king, also you cannot protect it. So the best move here is a3, not to have pawn on the color of the bishop. b3 was playing and is not a good move because you have two pawns on the color of the bishop. King e6, take, take, knight e3. Of course, you have to be careful because if you go without thinking what your opponent will do, it's very important to understand all the time what my opponent is going to do. Okay, this is very important in chess and in life also. King e4, knight d4 and c5. And now there are counter chances with knight c6. That's why it's better to play c5 at once. King d2 and king e4. Now, h6, you see, just take the pawn with bishop f7 and bishop h5. So the e5 pawn will be lost. And now you understand, if you have the pawn on a3, you have some chances to create a fortress because there are not too many pawns in the board. Bishop d5, knight b1, king f7, just creating some chances, looking for some chances, a6. If knight c4, you can take. Space is very important in the endgame. A king on the 5th rank wins the game. So knight c2 was played. King g4. King f2. King f4. Knight e3. And you see once more that everything is under control. Now, I want to go to e4, but knight g4 is on the air. So bishop e6. No, first b5, protect everything. And you see, create a chutzvank. If you go to f2, I go to the other side. Asymmetrical play. If you go to d2, I go to f3. Knight g2. Bishop g4. King d2, knight. Now I cannot come to f3 because this check and check. There is no reason. Also, maybe this is winning also because I have the h pawn. But there is no reason if you can win very easy not to allow counter chances to your opponent. And a very nice move. You see? I want to come to for the edge to pawn, but first I have to protect all my pawns. So c4. Take on c4, take with the bishop, a3, a5 and a4. If you go with knight e3, I come with king f3. If you are coming with knight e1, I'm coming to h3. Knight d4, h5. And coming with the king. White, black is winning because the h pawn will be a queen. Okay, let's see this one. And I think then we can make some questions, whatever you like, because I think you understand that the basic motives are the same and the same all the time. Okay? So, now, bishop c7, knight d7, we have the mutual choose bank, king e4, king e6, bishop d8, protecting everything. If you go to d7, g4, and now you are choose bank, knight c6, take the pawn. The idea is that black wants to play the knight to d4, but this is not enough. Bishop c3, and you see the role of the bishop is very important. I can my pawn to promote, I can attack your pawn. I'm playing on both sides. So I think now that we can make some Q&A, some questions, and speak about any position we saw today. If you can ask me whatever you like. Yes, can you help me?
Hello. Thank you so much, International Master Andreas. So if you would like to ask him any questions, please do so in the lecture chat text channel. Andreas, you can look there for any questions. Since we're not recording...
Where is this? Because I'm new one. Lecture chat, okay.
Yes, yes. So since we are not recording the chat window itself, if you'd like the question to be in the video, just read the question out loud and then respond to it so that the viewers know what the question is. So with that, please take your time to answer any questions or ask any questions to International Master Andreas, and I'll be recording the whole thing. Thank you.
Yes. Also, you can see my YouTube channel in the playlist. There are a lot of material. Okay, a lot of material. It's 95 videos. Go to the playlist. Don't look only the new one. Go to see the evaluation of a position. How to use time, space and material. This is very important. Okay. Because I want to explain something. That's why. So you see, if you go to the playlist, you will see a lot. Opposite color bishops. In the middle game, this is very interesting. In the beginning, the basic is very important for you all because it is how to evaluate a position with a new method that until now, it is very close to the computer. I never have a mistake of more than 0.3, so 0.3. So it is a very easy method to use space, time and material. We can do it in another lecture, okay, some times ago because there is a lot of work, but you can ask me whatever you like. Okay, this is very easy chess training. You see, it's a lot of material. Okay, we can go back to see what we speak. Okay.